So you say, how can I know? Well, you know when there's a progression of holiness, godliness, righteousness, Christ-likeness in your life. Less and less of sin, more and more of Christ. You see that you are more loving. Not just in your actions, but from your heart. You see that God is giving you a greater sense of humility. You have greater control over your temper. God is working in you so that you're not self-centered. You're not bitter. Not that you are perfect or completely flawless or sinless, but you see a progression. You see a maturing, because this is what the Holy Spirit does in your life. It kills sin. The Holy Spirit leads the children of God to wage war on sin. I believe if you are a Christian, a truly born-again man or woman, there will be an increasing hatred for sin in your life, because that's what the Holy Spirit does. The Holy Spirit leads you to wage war on sin, and it gives you a distaste for sin. Not to hate sin simply because of the consequences of sin, but you hate sin because it is hateful to God. You're seeing the things God sees. You're seeing it from the divine perspective. And that is a beautiful test if you are truly born again. I labor this point as we go through the book of Romans, because I think one of the scariest verses in the Bible is found in Matthew 7:22, where Jesus says, "Many will say unto me, Lord, Lord, didn't we prophesy in your name?" In other words, preach in your name. "Didn't we cast out devils? Didn't we do miracles?" And then Jesus turned and said unto them, "Depart from me, you workers of iniquity or sin. I never knew you." But you say, "I was born in a Christian home. I come to church every Sunday, you know. I say grace. I was baptized." But you were never born again. There has never been growth in your Christian life. You know it. 20 years as a Christian, you are still here. In fact, you're not even here. My friends, the scariest word to me in Matthew 7:22 is the word "many." It's not "any," okay? It's "many." 很多人,金嘴狼, whatever you want to call it. Huge crowds of people will come to Jesus on the last day and say, "Lord, we thought we knew you." Jesus says, "I never knew you. You had religiosity on the outside. You had tradition on the outside. But your heart, it was never born again. You never truly turned from your sin. You never really believed in what I've done for you on the cross. And you are without excuse, because all through your life, there has been no Christian growth, and you thought you could be a Christian. Your pastor said to you on, what's today's date? You remember today, huh? 27th of November, I wash my hands clean. The blood is not on my hands. I warn you, my friends, don't sit on presumption. Examine yourself if there be a growth in your life. Because the horrible reality is, I think many will face the Lord on the last day and it would be too late. So examine yourself whether ye be in the faith. But this is what the Spirit of God does. This is what a child of God would be like. A child of God is led by the Spirit of God to kill sin. Like I said, I don't think it's ever going to be complete or perfect. The Spirit of God leads us to sin less, but it doesn't enable us to be sinless. Get what I'm trying to say? You will sin less, but you will not be sinless in this life. It's only when Jesus comes again will you be totally sanctified and glorified. But you will sin less. And so, if I may, I think this is what it means to be growing as a Christian. This is what it should look like for your life. That with the passage of time, there will be less and less of self and more of Christ. Holiness, godliness, Christian maturity. A few problems with this chart. I like it, but still there are a few problems. Number one, it seems to tell you can reach a point where there will be no more sin. That's not true, as I've already explained. Number two, I think the progress of a Christian is not linear. There will be ups and downs. The gradient may change. But overall, the trend of your life should be less and less of self, because the Holy Spirit leads you to kill sin. The Holy Spirit forms Christ within you. So I think this is what it means to be a child of God. There's this distinctive mark, the way you walk. Haven't you seen that in father and son? A particular father walks in this way. Well, very say one. You look at the son will also walk this way. It's like father, like son, that's the way they walk. And if you are truly a child of God, more and more you'll walk like your father. You'll walk like the Lord Jesus Christ. So this is the distinctive mark number one. Let's look at number two, and that's found in Romans 8 and verse 15. I think the second hallmark is that there will be a warmth in a Christian's heart. There'll be warmth in God's child. There's a particular affection, tenderness in a child of God. Some months ago, I shared with you this picture of a young artist called Shen Han Mo. I was with Sean and we were at the Esplanade, and before the play started, we went around and looked at some paintings. Many nice paintings, but this one caught my eye particularly. It was drawn well, it's lifelike. But what was even more intriguing for me was the emotion, or rather the lack of emotion on their faces. This painting is drawn by this young man, Shen Han Mo, and this is what he wrote by the side. And don't strain your eyes, I'll read it for you. Father and son is a portrait of my father and I, one which reflects the nature of our relationship. My father has always been critical of me. For as long as I remember, he has never failed to come up with some form of criticism for nearly everything I do, including this painting. As much as I understand his positive intentions, there have been times when I have felt frustrated at his comments, which sometimes seem to put me down. In this portrait, the vacant gazes of the subjects suggest that there exists an emotional distance between them despite their close physical proximity. There's an emotional distance between them. But let me say this, that is not the will of God for you with regards to your relationship with Him. No. This is what God does. The Bible tells us earlier, as we went through Romans 5:5, that the love of God is shed abroad, that is poured out in our hearts by the Holy Ghost or Holy Spirit, which is given unto us. One of the reasons, one of the ministries for the Holy Spirit in our lives is that He manifests, reveals, pours out to us the love of God. This is the love of God to us, not our love for Him. This is God's love for us. It's made experiential, it's made real to us by the Holy Spirit. Because left to ourselves, we will not seek God. Left to ourselves, we are spiritually cold-blooded. Yesterday, I was with my son at Hort Park, and we were at the butterfly garden. And there, he was fascinated with the butterflies. He wanted to bring them home. But I told him, I don't know how to feed butterflies, so leave them there. But as he was amazed at all the butterflies, I took a look at what some of the signs read. I wanted to learn a little bit about the butterflies, and I learned something I didn't know in the past. And it says here, butterflies are cold-blooded insects. Hence, they will obtain and absorb the heat and energy they need by spreading out their wings under the sun. Many butterflies have dark-colored bodies which are better at conducting heat. So, butterflies are cold-blooded in and of themselves, and they need the heat of the sun to help them fly. I thought about it, isn't that the way I am? I'm cold-blooded in and of myself. I don't appreciate the love of God until the Holy Spirit shines in my life. That's what the Holy Spirit does. He brings afresh to you the love of God for you. Not only does He do this one-directional ministry, we also respond to God in love because of His ministry. And that's why we come to Romans 8:15. But for you have not received the spirit of bondage again to fear, but you have received the spirit of adoption whereby we cry, Abba, Father. So that is the work of the Holy Spirit again, to bring forth out of the response of the heart a love and intimacy and a seeking for God. In the past, you want to duck from God. You don't like to talk about spiritual things. You don't like to hear the name of God. You don't like to engage with Christians. You don't want all these things. And it's natural. That's the carnal man. That's the man before he knows God. But if he knows God, the Holy Spirit works in his heart that he understands the love of God and gives him a love for God. In the past, you were in a spirit of bondage. Bondage to sin, bondage to fears, bondage to guilt. Because you never know whether you are right with God. You never know you can match up to God's requirements. And so you duck from God. But once you have repented and trusted in Jesus, the Spirit lives in you and He is the Spirit of adoption. And out of that, He manifests a intimate, personal relationship with God. That's what He does. He enables you to cry. That's a deep emotive word, Abba, Father. The word Abba is a foreign language word, Aramaic word, that really is the same as what we will call Papa or Daddy. Papa, Dada, Daddy. That's what it is. Christians, we can call God, believe it or not, Papa, Daddy. Because that's the work of the Holy Spirit in your life. Now let me give you balance before you swing to an extreme. When the Bible tells us He gives us the spirit of adoption that we can cry, Daddy, Abba, Papa, Father, it doesn't mean that we can be presumptuous with God. Neither does it mean that we can be flippant with God or irreverential with God. No, not at all. Because the same Spirit that gives us the Spirit of adoption enables us to recognize that He is Lord. 1 Corinthians 12 verse 13 says, no man can say that Jesus is the Lord, sovereign, king, ruler, but by the Holy Ghost. I want to say this. We live in a day and age where churches, Christians, preach a kind of a casual, flippant relationship with God. I think that's dangerous. That's presumptuous. That's irreverential. They say as a Christian, you do not need the fear of God anymore. No, I see that frequently in the Bible. The Bible tells me it is the fear of God that is the beginning of wisdom. The Bible tells me in Acts 9:31 that the Christians, the early church Christians, walked in the fear of God. There was a healthy reverence and awe for who God is. 2 Corinthians 7:1, perfecting holiness in the fear of God. And Ephesians 5, submitting in the fear of God. So, let's keep this in balance. Our relationship with God is not as simplistic as just Father, Son. It is one dimension of it. But the Bible equally tells me shepherd, sheep, Lord, servant, king, subject. And you've got to take that in its biblical revelation. So it is true that we today have a particular, wonderful, confident, assured access and intimacy with God. But let it not be presumptuous or flippant.